sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him,
thank you. So we come to our final selection. And I saw you all checking the clock. Don't worry, we'll get out on time. Meaning we'll take the full time. It's only like 7:45 or something. Logan and I talked about this piece at the end of his sophomore year. So like 2 years ago now. 3 years? Four? I don't know how many years ago that was. And I said, man, I'd love to do this, but it really takes a pianist. It really takes a pianist. So I gave him the music, and he kept reminding me about that. You know, you said we could do this. You said we could do this. It's the Beethoven Choral Fantasy. How many of you are familiar with the Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy? I kind of see some hands in the darkness. What Beethoven did with that was bring in voices in an otherwise instrumental genre. The fantasy is often performed by just a piano or an organ, and it's really on the performer to make up a theme, and then often they would do theme and variations, which means they play the theme, and then here's, look at all the way I can vary this and show off my skill. That's what we're doing tonight. No, just kidding. Beethoven wrote this piece, the Choral Fantasy, as a conclusion, a finale for a concert that lasted a mere 4 hours. So I figure we got plenty of time. He premiered the Fifth and the Sixth Symphony that night, and then wrote this, and in probably typical Beethoven fashion, gave the music to the performers while the ink was still wet, meaning he finished it on the way in, and probably made up the first part, though Logan's not making it up tonight, but he probably made that up at the time. So, the idea was to bring together all the performing forces and have a big grand finale. So you listen for the theme, because it's a long piece. I'm going to tell you that now. You don't need to take a nap. It'll get exciting. You listen for the theme, and then you listen for it passed around. It'll start with the flute, and then the oboe has it, then the clarinets have it, and then the strings have it, and then there's some variations. Well, how the theme is different. That way, since most of you students took music appreciation a long time ago, it's a little refresher for you, right? All right? So Beethoven's Choral Fantasy.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, what a privilege to have you here tonight. As I walked in, I saw so many alumni, so many parents. We have 87 graduates tomorrow. And I think if you think back 4 years ago when you dropped one of the most precious things in your life off here at our campus, and a lot of you cried all the way home and walked in your home and saw that empty bedroom and cried again. And now you cried on your way here to say, what am I going to do with that new craft room if my child comes back home again? I think that pit that you had in your stomach when you dropped your student off is probably welled up with pride as you get to see them graduate tomorrow. And someone said, what's the difference between a college and a Bible college? Like, why would these graduates choose to come to a Bible college? Maybe your family or friend here tonight and you're saying, that is a great question. I would say the primary difference is at a Bible college, we really think that the most important thing is what happens after you die. What happens next? All of the graduates, all of the people behind me believe there's another life after this life. And they all believe that that is the most important thing. You know, there's going to be a lot of graduations tomorrow. A lot of graduations are going to graduate from schools, and the graduates are going to be told, go out and make a name for yourself. And tomorrow you're going to see our graduates get a towel that says, be great, serve. And our graduates are going to be told, go out and make Christ known. Make his name great. You're going to see a lot of graduates tomorrow are told, hey, go out and make a point. Our graduates are going to be told, go out and make a difference. And I really believe our graduates will. And I would encourage you tonight, if someone were to ask you if you were to die, we don't want that to happen, but it's going to happen to all of us at some point. If you were to die, do you know for sure that the moment after you die, you'd wake up in heaven? The Bible tells us there's one of two places. You're either going to go to hell or go to heaven. And all these people chose to come to a Bible college because they believe in those two places after death. And they really want, number one, to be prepared to go out and share that with as many people as possible. In order to go to heaven, being a Baptist doesn't get you into heaven. If you know anything about the Bible, it's not a Baptist book, Catholic book, Lutheran book, it's just God's word. And I'd ask you tonight, have you ever had anyone take a Bible and show you from a Bible what you have to do to go to heaven? The Bible says we're all sinners. There's not one perfect person in this room. In order to automatically go to heaven, you'd have to be absolutely perfect. And yet the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. No one's perfect. So then we need a Savior. A very good friend of mine, Dr. Marty Heron, has gone skydiving twice. He's jumped out of a perfectly good airplane at 14,000 feet. And when you jump out of an airplane at 14,000 feet, he said, it was the greatest rush I've ever had. He said, Jim, it's amazing. He says, you go tandem on your first jump, you're strapped to someone else, and you both jump out of the plane. And for over a minute, you don't pull the chute. He says, you jump out of the plane and you get sucked backwards. And he said, it's the weirdest feeling. You literally feel like you're flying. He says, for a minute, you absolutely feel like you're flying, but in reality, you're falling. And after a minute, that person on the tandem pulls the ripcord. And I thought, what a great illustration for life. You might be here tonight and you say, I don't need God, I'm flying. When in reality, you're falling. And without Jesus Christ, if you don't pull the ripcord, no one survives a fall of 14,000 feet. You need a parachute. You need a Savior. And you might be here tonight and say, man, life is going great. Everything's awesome. I don't need God. I don't need to worry about that. I'm young. But you're not flying. You're actually falling. And you need a Savior. And being a Baptist won't get you into heaven, but Jesus Christ can. The Bible says that's why he died on a cross. He was the only perfect one. And he died on a cross to pay for our sins. And to avoid falling and going into a Christless eternity, you need a Savior, Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10:10, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, what we all celebrate at Easter time, you will be saved. For with the heart, man believes into righteousness. That means you're going to do the right thing. With the mouth, confession is made into salvation. It seems easy, but it's hard to really believe. And I love the students behind me. You know, I came here 8 years ago for the first time. I'm not from faith. I'd been in Iowa twice in my entire lifetime when I interviewed for this position. And I was up in Canada pastoring, had no intention of leaving. In fact, I told the search committee, I'm not planning to come. And this can't leak back to my church. And we had secret interviews. So the first event after we God did a great work, and long story, God wanted me to come. They said, we want you to come to the commencement concert. This is the first event I'd ever attended on Faith's campus. And I would say 8 years ago, my wife and I sat right over here, and we listened, and we just loved the music. And I loved it again tonight. But the difference tonight than 8 years ago is 8 years ago, all I loved was the music. And tonight I love the music, and I love the students who performed it. And I am confident that these students are going to go out and do some wonderful things for the cause of Christ. And every family member here tonight, you have a lot to be proud of. I'm a big fan of Louis L'Amour. I don't get to read him very often, but he makes a statement about his friends. He makes the statement, you're welcome at my fire anytime. And I feel that way about our graduates. They're welcome at our fire anytime. But I know that they're all here. They chose a Bible college. If you come to a Bible college, you can major in a lot of things, but you have to double major at a Bible college. You're going to have a major plus, you're going to have a major in Bible. And that doesn't make sense unless you believe there's another life after this life. And if you really believe that, it makes total sense. And these students have put in a great effort so that they can be the tandem person pulling the ripcord and trying to save people from an eternity without Christ. And for that, I'm so proud of all of them. And if they were here tonight, and I'm the one speaking on their behalf, they would just say, if you're a family member and you go, I don't know why they did this. Why did they go to a Bible college? Let me encourage you. Let them or someone else here take a Bible. It doesn't take very long. And it's your choice. No one can make you become a Christian. But if you're not sure, if you were to die, you'd wake up in heaven. You can. The Bible says these things are written that you may know that you have eternal life. That's why God wrote the Bible. So you don't have to be afraid to die. I became a Christian at a Bible college when I was 19. We had two of our students also trust Christ this year. And the best thing for me after 19 was I wasn't afraid to die anymore. And you don't have to either. I say to our students, if you're a Christian, the worst thing that can happen is you wake up tomorrow and you're still here. Because if you're in heaven, that's not bad. And you can know that as well. And it's nothing to do with being a Baptist. It's nothing to do with the church. But it's everything to know with Jesus Christ and knowing him as a Savior. You're not flying without him. You're falling. But with him, it can be the greatest experience of your life. And if Marty Herring could tell you about jumping out of an airplane, that's what he told me. Jim was the greatest experience of my life. But he could only live to tell me that if the parachute opened. And we all need Jesus Christ as our Savior. Let me encourage you, think about that tonight. And if you came to support a family member and you don't know Christ as your Savior, I know they'd love to explain it to you. And for all of you who are here tonight, say, I do know that. I hope this is a wonderful weekend of celebration of a ton of hard work. I mean, on top of schoolwork, they did this. And they put a lot of effort into doing this tonight. And we're very thankful. I'd like to ask Sherry Nicholson if she would come tonight. She's still here. Sherry has directed our handbells. And we've done a lot of extra things this year. This was our 100th anniversary. So we did an amazing outdoor concert. And she has overseen all of our handbells. So Sherry, we just want to give you a small gift for you and your husband to go take a night out on us. So thank you very much. Let's give Sherry a hand. Dr. Chris Ellis, if you were here for our 100th, we did an unbelievable outdoor concert. And our students didn't have a lot of time. He gave them the music over the summer. It was our 100th year. It's a big deal. And then a lot of them didn't get the music till they actually arrived in the fall. And I said to Dr. Chris, are you sure you can pull this off? And he's like, oh, yeah, no problem. I honestly was still skeptical right up to the night of the event. I mean, we had like 1,000 people here. Senator Grassley came. And if you're here that night, it was an amazing concert. Just an amazing job. That was on top of all the other concerts we do throughout the year. And Dr. Chris has just done an incredible job with the orchestra and the chorale and the chamber choir. And so, Dr. Chris, we have something for you too. So if you come on up, let's give Dr. Chris a hand. So my very first concert when I came here, I was so moved by the music, I just got up, I didn't know anything, and I just said, hey, I think we need to have an encore. And everyone just went nuts and said, absolutely. And Dr. Van was here back then, and he didn't have one prepared. So, but they pulled one off. And so I think they always prepare now in case I would say this again. Did you enjoy the concert tonight? Let's ask for an encore again tonight. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I hope you have a wonderful time with your families here. We look forward to tomorrow, to commencement that begins at 10:30, Awards Chapel at some other time, 8. I'll be here. Have a good evening. You are dismissed.